Whee! Okay, that's good news. Many questions today. This is usually what happens. The more you get into the retreat, the more questions there are. And the last day is just a big pile of questions, which is very nice. It means people are getting into it. That's good. Okay, so the first one tonight. Ajahn, is there such a thing as wrong samadhi? I know people who can sit for hours, bliss out, for many years, but there is no observable improvement in their virtues. Still, they are bad-tempered and egoistic, according to the people who live with these meditators. Sometimes you just don't know. Sometimes people think that they bliss out and they have a state of samadhi, and maybe they don't. I don't know. People make all kind of crazy mistakes sometimes. So maybe they don't have the kind of samadhi they think they have. Or if they live bad lives and they are egoistic and angry, then in the long run, their samadhi is going to decline. Yeah, because this is just the nature of things. You may be born into this life with some strong characteristics from the past life, and then in this life, so you have those strong things coming from the past life, but then in this life you start doing crazy things. So you're going to carry with you some of those good characteristics, and you may be able to carry on for a while with samadhi and still do stupid things, but eventually it will have bad results. So there's many possibilities here. One is simply that they don't have the samadhi they think they have, or maybe they only had it a few times, and they're already declining, or they are been declining already for, or it's something they had from a past life. It's very hard to know. The thing is that people are so complex. We have so many character traits, and they kind of cross each other, and sometimes, some people are on the way up, other people are on the way down, other people are more stagnating. What is the most important thing is to be a person on the way up. That is where you want to be. Someone who is improving, that's the point. If you are a samadhi person but you are declining, it's pointless. Because samadhi in its own right is not the kind of the outcome of the path. The outcome of the path is to go beyond that eventually. So if you are declining, no help in having samadhi. So is there such a thing as wrong samadhi? There is a Miccha samadhi in the suttas, but it doesn't refer to this. What Miccha Samadhi refers to in the suttas is a samadhi that comes with wrong view. It's a kind of samadhi the Buddha had before his awakening when he practiced under those two teachers, Alara Kalama and Udaka Ramaputta, when it looks like he attained the very highest stages of samadhi, even the immaterial attainments. Maybe, possibly, we discussed that the other day. But whatever that was, it would have been wrong because it was based on wrong view. And for that reason, it cannot lead to liberation. Yeah? Samadhi, even if it is good, deep stillness, if it's based on wrong view, it can't lead to liberation because it means you misunderstand what that samadhi is. You come there and you take it to mean something it doesn't. Instead of having an open mind and inquiring fully into that state, you have a predetermined idea of what it means. It means God, it means something like that, and you stop your investigation at that point because you have achieved what that religion wants you to achieve. This is classically what happens in Hinduism. The purpose of the path in Hinduism, in Advaita Vedanta, as they call it, Advaita Vedanta non-duality teachings, is to find that unity between Brahma and Atma. Brahma being the cosmic principle and Atma being your inner core. Yeah, that unity between the two things. And of course, that is exactly what it feels like in samadhi. You feel unified, you feel blissful, you feel all these things that you would expect to find with a supreme God like Brahma. And that is really what wrong samadhi means in the suttas. If you have a look at the sutta like the Maha Chattarisaka Sutta, which is Majjhima Nikaya 117, the Great 40, it specifically says in there that samadhi is conjoined with the other seven factors of the Noble Eightfold Path. When all those factors come together, then it's Samma Samadhi. It's not Samma Samadhi in its own right. There's another sutta called the Effacement Sutta, Majjhima Nikaya number 8, and there the Buddha starts off with talking about samadhi kind of leading in the wrong direction. Yeah, and in that sutta, it clearly refers to samadhi, which is based on wrong view. Same thing, same idea, same problem there. And it's an interesting one, because in that sutta, he talks about deep states of samadhi kind of going wrong, people stopping in the practice. Salekha Sutta, it's called in Pali, Majjhima Nikaya 8, effacement. He talks about how samadhi is wrong. And then later on, he says, so instead of this wrong samadhi, you should practice the Noble Eightfold Path, including samadhi, including Samma Samadhi. So it's as if samadhi is wrong at the beginning of the sutta, but at the end of the sutta, samadhi is right. So how is that possible? Well, the reason why that is possible is because at the beginning, it's talking about Miccha Samadhi, based on wrong view, and then it's talking about Samma Samadhi, based on right view. That's how samadhi can be both wrong and right within the space of a few pages in the suttas. Many people use the Salekha Sutta to talk about the dangers of samadhi, but that's really the wrong way of thinking about it. It's only the danger of samadhi if you have wrong view. Yeah, Salekha Sutta is a classical sutta used for that kind of purpose to say samadhi can be dangerous. But samadhi is only dangerous if you practice it in the wrong, with the wrong assumptions and wrong views. Normally, people with samadhi will be very kind and gentle people, but they will also have a very strong mind, people with samadhi, and because they have a very strong mind, they can come across as quite strong characters. Yeah, this is one of the things you will see here. And that sometimes may come out as, you know, seeming harsh or whatever, but you have to look carefully if they really are harsh or it's just a strong personality which is responsible for that. Sometimes it can be hard to trace the difference. You have to look carefully whether it is real anger or ill will or whether it's something else going on. All the big ajans around the world, the Aryas, very often people like Ajahn Chah or whoever, they often have very strong personalities. Those kind of people were a little bit afraid of them. So, except for Ajahn Gana, he has a very gentle personality. Okay. Anjali Ajahn, in the evening, monastics are allowed to take honey cheese prunes. Not ordinary prunes, but some kind of medicinal prunes, perhaps. But dark chocolate, non-dairy drinks, fruit juices. So, similarly, 8 precepts can also do the same. Sure, you can also do the same. Yay, hooray, now we can take more things. It's good news, isn't it? Don't take these 8 precepts too seriously, because sometimes people become really nitpickers about what is allowable for the 8 precepts. Be pretty relaxed about it. The idea is that you abstain from food, you abstain, don't be kind of too serious about these things. Find that kind of nice balance where you are, use these things wisely. Otherwise, if you don't use them wisely, you become like a kind of, become a very doctrinal about what can be used and what cannot, which is not really all that useful. Definitely you can use all of those things, and it's good to limit it, of course. But some of those things are already debatable, like cheese, for example, is debatable in monastic circles whether it really is what is meant by this Pali word. The Pali word is Navanitang. Does Navanitang mean cheese? Probably not exactly like cheese, but maybe close enough. This is how the debates go, and this kind of debates go on forever. Yeah, In Thailand, cheese is like a European import to large parts of Asia. There wasn't any cheese really in Asia until fairly recent times. So some of the Ajahns in Thailand, they didn't know what cheese was. They didn't know what Navanitang was. It was all kind of a bit out of the blue. So they said, oh yeah, close enough, it will do. And so then we have kind of inherited that tradition and we sort of shrug our shoulders and say, yeah, okay, good enough. So that's how it works. Sometimes it's a bit random, yeah, how these things actually work out. So we don't take it so super seriously, because it's not these kind of things that may, decide at the end of the day whether you're going to make progress or not. If you argue too much about these tiny little things, you're more likely to not make progress. So you find you have to be reasonable sometimes. Okay, anyway, I've got good news for you. You can do the same. So that's good. Okay, dear Ajahn, if right time, right speech were used to tell a person that his behavior and attitude is harming a relationship and making the other person unhappy, is still not getting through, what other ways are there? The person seemed to have built a wall to block out the discussion. Thank you. Well, one of the things you can do is, I don't know if you have these things in Malaysia, but sometimes there are relationship counselors, and they can be very useful, because the point of a relationship counselor is not necessarily that they know better than you, but to have a third person involved means that it's more difficult for either party, you or the other party, to kind of you know, bias the debate or make the debate about them or whatever. So a third party is usually very useful, because they are like a neutral ground between two arguing people. Yeah? So go to a relationship counselor. Maybe they have relationship counselor here at BGF. Do you have relationship counselors? Do you have people who, yeah? Okay, use that, yeah, use those. They're probably even nice as well. They're kind of friendly and based on Buddhist principles or whatever. So come with a third party person and try to talk things out. And then it is much less likely that one side will be able to stonewall, as they call it, and not listen and block it all out. You're gonna, first of all, you have to try to commit the other person to make them see that they're, you know, at least, please come with me. I feel there is a problem. So for my sake, out of compassion for me, please come and we can sort this out. When you talk to them, don't make it into their problem, because then they won't listen to you. But make it into your suffering, yeah? It's difficult for me. I find this really hard. And I would like to do this so I can try to resolve this only for my sake. And maybe it will be beneficial for both of us, but it's really for me. So can you please do it for me? If you are my husband or wife, yeah? It's really important that you help me out. I mean, what's the point of being a husband and wife if we can't help each other out on these things? There's no point. So maybe then the best thing to do is get a divorce. Yeah, maybe just say goodbye, enough. It doesn't work out. You know what I mean? This is kind of a minimum requirement of a husband and wife, that you're willing to try to sort out problems and suffering for the other party. Otherwise, just too hard. So try that. That's what I would recommend. Because after a while, if you keep on arguing with each other, you just don't get anywhere. It's not gonna work. You're not gonna change anyone's mind. You just dig deeper into the kind of the hole that you're already digging. And no way you're gonna get out of those. So try that and see what happens. And maybe, hopefully, that will help you out. Okay. Dear Ajahn, one, if each of the stages of awakening correspond to the four levels of jhana, does it mean that one becomes an arahant in the fourth jhana? How about the total cessation of perception and consciousness, the level you after the immaterial realms? I have heard that one becomes an arahant after coming out of this level and state. Well, it's not that each jhana corresponds to the four stages of awakening. That wasn't really what I was trying to say. What I was trying to say is that the jhanas and the stages of awakening are generally on the same level. Yeah, in many ways, they are very closely related to each other, because they share a lot of the similar characteristics. The characteristics are great sense of selflessness, great sense of bliss, yeah, a great sense of having given up most of the world. There's only a little bit of the world to leave out. The happiness that you have is almost the same. Yeah, so it has a lot of the same characteristics. So the Buddha places them on the same level. It's not that they correspond to each other, it's just that he places these eight things roughly on the same level. Yeah, that is what it really is about. So what about the cessation of perception and feeling? Sanya, Vedayata, Nirodha, what about that? Yes, when you come out of that, you are one of two things. Either you're an arahant or anagami, non-returner. And the reason for that is because you have seen the cessation of everything. Very hard to cling on to anything after that. You see the cessation of everything and you realize that the ending of everything is better than there being anything at all. That's what that is all about. And it's very hard to grasp. And I think the only way to really see it is to be an Aryan before you can really grasp why that is the case, why the ending of everything is better than there being anything at all. But yes, because you have seen that, then there is almost, most probably you become an Arahant at that stage, and if not, an Anagami. That's the kind of standard way of viewing that. And it's from the suttas actually here. Does Pamoja also mean relief? That's interesting. Does it mean relief? I would say so. I would say each stage of meditation is a greater relief than the previous one. Because what are you relieved from? You're relieved from suffering. Yeah, this is the relief, basically. All the oppressions in our mind and our life really are sufferings in a certain way. And one of the kind of the Buddha's way of talking about breathing, one of the ways of him to talk about the idea of relief for being at ease, is you breathe easily. Yeah, that's one of the words in the suttas used for that. Because when you are really relaxed, you breathe easily. There's no tension in the body. The breathing is really at ease, and you are, you know, just sitting there. And this is one of the things that happens. The deeper you go in your meditation, everything feels so much better. You feel all these problems of the world are left behind, and you really, as you say, there is a kind of relief there, relief from a burden, relief from all of these things that you have to do in the world. It's like a holiday. Yeah, so enjoy your holiday. This is like a holiday camp. Welcome to the holiday camp. Does it feel like a holiday camp? Or does it feel like a torture camp? Some people, you go on read, some people think it's a torture camp, some people say it's a holiday camp, and some people are just snoring away here. So it's kind of the three categories. So which one are you in? Make it into a holiday camp, yeah? Snoring away is okay, that's the intermediate stage, that's fine. Let's snore a little bit, but eventually make it into a holiday camp. This is the real holiday camp. People think traveling overseas is fun, but traveling overseas is nothing. What are you going to get from going overseas? It's all the same anyway. Okay, the food is a bit different, the scenery is a bit different. Big deal. It's just the sensual realm, the various varieties of the sensual realm. More of the same, different types of the same thing, yeah? Oh, I want to taste this kind of food, I want to see these sights. It doesn't really make any difference in your life. And for that reason, this is the real holiday camp. This is where you take a real break from samsara. This is where you recharge your batteries. Your energy comes back up. Yeah? This is what is so beautiful about the meditation practice. It re-energizes you. You will have noticed that when you think too much, as someone said today, you feel tired after a while. Naturally, yeah, you sit in meditation, you think and think and think, and then you go into sloth and torpor because you are exhausting yourself from all the thinking. So not thinking is a holiday. Yay, now the energy is coming back. You can feel the energy returning when your mind is quiet. So yes, relief is a good way of thinking about it. I don't know if Pamoja can be translated as relief, because I don't think it has that literal meaning. It's related to mudita, that word. Mudita means like sympathetic joy or something like that. It's more in the joy area of things. But it is part of what happens as you practice. So that sounds quite right. Number three is a silly question. It says here, silly question with a smiley face. So it's a smiley, silly question. That's good. I said yesterday that silly questions were good, so this must be you taking the opportunity, I suppose, which is great. Thank you for following my advice. How did Ajahn Brahm keep his body upright when he was in samadhi? In the story that you mentioned, why doesn't the body topple over? Thank you, Ajahn. That's what bodies don't topple over in samadhi. They stay where they are. Yeah, that's what they do. You have I don't know why, but that's just what happens. So I guess you relax and relax and relax. And if the body was meant to topple over, it would topple over before samadhi, not while you are in samadhi, because you have relaxed it to 100%. You're really happy in that position, and that position then remains as a consequence. So it doesn't do that in samadhi. It's like you are locked in. It stays that way. In fact, when you come out of samadhi, you feel ultra relieved, ultra relaxed, really at super at ease. This is one of the characteristics of samadhi practice. So if you had any pains as you were entering, when you come out, you never have any pains. The body is completely 100% at ease, regardless for how long you have been sitting. You've been sitting for 20 hours, there's not a pain in the body. It's like magic. Yeah, you know what I mean? How can you sit for 20 hours without any pain in the body? How is that possible? The reason is because you have given it all up and the body really is completely relaxed. Pain is impossible. This is a little bit, it is a little bit magical almost when you think about it, except that every one of us can experience this right there. These are like the mundane magics of the path. So if you want a little bit of magic in your life, this is the way to go. So it doesn't topple over, it stands still. Yeah. In fact, if you practice really deep samadhi, not only does the body not move, according to some one sutta, you can't destroy the body at that particular point. The body becomes indestructible. That is that, you know, you probably know this story already, but that's in that sutta called the Maharatajaniya Sutta, where there is this fellow, this monk who goes into Sanya Vidayata Niroda, the cessation of perception and feeling, where everything stops. And then he sits there on the ground, and when you sit there in Sanya Vidayata Niroda, there's no breathing, there's nothing, you just sit there completely still like a rock. And then these two people looking out for firewood, yeah, two fellows kind of collecting firewood, they see this monk and think, wow, poor monk, he has died right there in meditation, yeah, let's do our duty and cremate him. So that this is the danger of going into real deep meditation, people might cremate you, so keep that in mind before you go in there. No, I shouldn't say that, then you might become fearful of the meditation, so that's the, there's no danger, yeah, this is the point of the story. So they build up a big pile of fire, and then they take the monk, and they grab hold of the monk, and they put him on top. Yeah, dick, put him on top. And then they light the fire, and they burn the fire, and while the fire is burning, they think, yeah, that's good enough. And then they leave. And the next morning, they go into town, because they always offer alms in the morning to the monks. Yeah, so they offer alms, one bowl, the next bowl, the third bowl. Wow, it's the monk that we cremated yesterday. What are you doing here? What you're supposed to be a pile of ash, you're not supposed to be a human body. And the reason is that if you go into these states, you're supposed to be untouchable by fires. Is it true? Don't know, I have no idea. It sounds a bit over the top, but this is, at least according to this sutta, that's what happens. So when you come out of that meditation after 3 days, you wonder what all the ash is all about. Well, how come there's so much ash here? It's like something has burned, yeah? So then you get up, you brush the ashes off your robe. Apparently your robes also are untouched, yeah? Brush the ashes off your robe, and then you carry on, and you walk on. That's the idea. I don't know if it's true. I must admit, I find it a little bit hard to believe, but maybe it is true, because there are some strange things going on sometimes. The power of the mind is great. Maybe I should try. Venerable, we can't fight about which one of us should try this. Okay. Dear Ajahn, do you have encountered any unseen beings, spirits in your practice? What do you think of charms and black magic, which is pretty common in Southeast Asia? Have I seen any spirits and unseen beings in practice? Not really, I don't have any doubts that they exist, but I don't really I can't really say I have seen any such beings. It's obvious that they are there. It's obvious that these beings actually exist, and many people see them, and I think it's a great fortune to see such beings. If you see such a being, you should be happy, because it gives you a different dimension on the world, on reality. Most people, when they see the world, they think this, what you have right now, is all there is to the world. This opens your mind up to another dimension. You start to understand the world is much more complex and much more diverse than what we think it is. And this opens up your view to that possibility. So if you see a ghost, you should say, thank you, ghost, for visiting me here. Yeah. Wonderful, yeah. And you should, and then you will, do a bit of chanting for the ghost and give something to the ghost and share your merits with it, and then the ghost will be very happy. But generally speaking, as a human being, you don't have too much to fear from a ghost. Ghosts can't do all that much to you. So you don't have too much to worry, especially if you are a good person. You keep your virtue pure. Basically, there's nothing a ghost can do to you. So don't worry so much about the ghost, and especially if you are grateful for being able to see a ghost, then there's nothing at all. Like, oh, thank you, ghost. What a wonderful thing. Welcome, my friend, the ghost. And you can give it a name, Mr. Ghost or Mrs. Ghost or whatever, when you see them. So what about black magic and this kind of things? A lot of black magic is psychological manipulation, I think. You tell people that you have been given black magic, and then you believe in it so strongly that, you know, whatever they are trying to do to you, it happens because you believe it. So believing it, I think, is often the first problem. Is it possible to do black magic in kind of, if someone is very, very powerful? Maybe. But I think the vast majority of people who do black magic, they're just charlatans. And they are dodgy characters who don't really know what they're doing at all. And then the idea is to psychologically manipulate people so that they believe these things. And then it may still work, even though it's, you know, it doesn't actually... may not be effective from that person's point of view. You have to have some very special and unusual characteristics to do black magic. Usually you need samadhi, and also you need to be a little bit evil. And that usually that doesn't go together. If you have samadhi, you can't be all that evil. Otherwise samadhi will disappear. So it is very unlikely for these things to happen. Can it never happen? I don't know. I'm not sure. But I have never seen any convincing examples myself of black magic. There are people who come to the monastery and say that they have been done black magic against them. And it's obvious to me when I see them that they have psychological problems. That's the real truth. Yeah, they have some. They should really go and see a psychiatrist and get it sorted out. But it's very hard to convince someone who is sure that there are forces outside of them manipulating them. It's very hard to convince them to see a psychiatrist. Because they are so sure that the problem is outside, and they won't really listen to you. I tried to convince this one fellow, I was trying to be very gentle with him. I said, maybe you should kind of, you know, all of these things you're doing is good, you know, chanting and whatever, and trying to do, but maybe just to get a bit of extra help, go and see a psychologist as well. But it didn't really seem to have make any impact on this person at all when I said that. It was like, oh yeah, and then he forgot about it straight away, I think. A lot of it is psychological problems that people have, and very often, when people have psychological problems, they want to find an excuse. They want to find a reason why they have it. It's very hard to accept that this is a psychological problem. It feels like, like something, like you have kind of diminishing yourself in some way. But there is around the world, everywhere around the world, there is a certain percentage of people who have psychological problems. It's that every society has the same thing. There's nothing to be embarrassed about. It's just life, really. Life is like that. And if you happen to be one of those people, then much better to seek the right kind of help rather than to mess around thinking it's black magic or external forces and all of these kind of things and not getting kind of not help that might even make it worse sometimes. Okay. The other one was charms. I didn't talk about charms. Maybe this is the opposite, like medallions and that kind of thing. Forget about those medallions. It's voodoo Buddhism medallions. It's not really Buddhism at all. So leave those out. And it's kind of getting down the wrong track. Dear Ajahn, why does my mind feel groggy? And falls into a dreamlike state during meditation? Why does it happen during meditation but not during work and study? Thank you in advance. Well, when you are work and study, you are exerting yourself, you are using your willpower consistently. And that's why the mind keeps awake, the willpower keeps it awake, but not really at ease. Your mind is not 100% at ease when you are awake and studying in this way, because you're putting in that force which drives the mind and keeps it awake. When you are coming to meditation, you are learning to relax. And because you are relaxing, that force which keeps it awake during work and study is no longer there. You're no longer making that effort. And for that reason, the mind then goes all over the place and does weird things, like becoming groggy, and dreamlike states and these such things. It's kind of natural, so don't worry too much about it. Your mind is tired, that's why these things have happened. And maybe you have abused your mind a little bit over long periods of time. You have been pushing it around, telling it to do all kinds of things that maybe it doesn't really like to do. You know, when you work, sometimes your work is fun, other times your work is boring. You still have to do it. So how do you get through it? Well, the way you get through it is by pushing yourself, by using willpower. So if you have been doing that for so long, then it becomes very hard to let go of it, very hard to kind of let go. And willpower that is there means that, you know, your mind is kind of been tired out for a very long period of time, which makes sleep and grogginess in meditation much more likely as a consequence. So that's why it's happening. So that's why I said the middle stage is snoring. That's the middle stage of meditation. Yeah, you go from being a prison camp to being a snoring camp. But that's already a good move. Much better not to torture yourself. That is the worst one. Then you go through the snoozing and snoring and dreamlike state, and then you come out into the kind of holiday camp at the other end. Yeah, kind of these are the three ways of thinking about these meditation practices. So don't worry too much about it. Keep on living well as a Buddhist. Do all the basic things. Try not to push yourself too much in ordinary life either. Not to push yourself too hard. Keep on doing the right thing. Eventually, you will find your way through this. But don't think that pushing yourself in meditation is going to help out. It's not. It's going to make the problem worse. So just accept the fact that you are in a dreamlike state. Many, many people are like this, and it's okay. It's just nature. Okay, will the Christians be reborn in lower realms for believing in the Creator God as they have wrong views? Ooh, okay. It depends on what kind of wrong view you have. Yeah, it's not just any kind of wrong view that will lead to a lower realm, and it also depends on what those wrong views do to you as a person, what kind of actions are the consequences of those wrong views. And it is particularly those wrong views that lead to bad conduct that are bad. Yeah. So if you have wrong views that lead to evil conduct, then you are in real trouble. Wrong views such as this, like eternalism or whatever, it's in itself is quite benign. It doesn't really lead to any big problems. So if a Christian lives a good life, they too will go to heaven. Are you okay with that? Will you accept the Christians into heaven? Yeah, yeah. Or do you feel jealous? Oh, I'm finally being a good Buddhist. I'm going to go to heaven. I don't want the Christians to be there. But they will. Except that in heaven, it's just like the human realm. The Christians are in one corner of heaven. Buddhists are in a different corner. Yeah. Because we hang out with each other. We hang out with each other. So you Christians are there, Muslims are there, atheists are there. Everyone has a group in the heavenly realm. But we bring, it's probably true, right? Because this is how it is in the human realm. Buddhists hang out together, Muslims hang out together. So probably some truth to that. And then we carry on our views and we carry on this separation in the heavenly realm. There was actually a teacher who said this. He said, I don't know if it's true, but he said that he had visited the heavenly realms, and this is what he saw. He saw this kind of different religions in different places. I don't know. So yes, the answer is yes. Christians, if they live well, they will also go to heaven, just like good Buddhists. Yeah. So exactly. Here. Okay, in the Sanguttara Nikaya 42.2, the Talaputta Sutta, it is said that an actor would be reborn in hell of laughter, to Nisra Bhikkhu's translation. Why is that the case, as acting seems like a harmless job? And I think in this case, it really depends what kind of actor you are. Yeah, there are different kinds of acting. There is acting which is done to kind of to maybe... You know, you make a film that is some kind of based on some kind of reality where you actually are teaching people something. Many film movies are based on real incidents, for example. It may be informative and useful. It may have a moral ending and all of these kind of things. So it really depends on what kind of acting we're talking about. But a lot of the acting at the time of the Buddha was like just joking around, doing all kind of weird things, and maybe kind of deluding people in a sense. And I think that is where the problem is. If you are acting for the harm of other people by deluding them, by doing things that kind of make them even act and think according, not according to reality, but just whatever it is, I think that is often where the problem arises. So it depends on the purpose of the film. It depends on how you are doing things. It depends on what kind of actor you are. Yeah, there was one interesting incident. There was a Australian actor who played, what was it, the Joker in Batman. You know, Batman and the Joker. Yeah, yeah. So and this Joker character is, he got into that role very, very heavily, and it was very hard to deal with because it was such an evil character. Is it an evil character? Is that right? Joker? Bad character? Yeah? Okay. So, and he really got into it very deeply, and it caused lots of mental anguish and things afterwards, and he ended up dying through either drug overdose or suicide. I can't remember exactly the reason. I think that was a classic example of almost moving in to another state of mind that you create yourself, yeah, to the point where it becomes unbearable to actually be yourself anymore. Instead of developing your mind in kindness and goodness, you actually develop your mind to become someone else, an evil character. And that can be, obviously, can be very, very hard. And you can see in that case, it might be really bad. So I would say it depends a lot on what you do, yeah, and it's not as one-sided as every actor will be reborn in hell. I don't think that's the case. I think I think it depends on circumstances. When one intends to become a monastic, how does one find a suitable teacher and a suitable monastery for him or her? How does a monastic get his or her name? Can he or she choose a name for themselves? You want to choose your name? Is that right? You want. What name would you like to have? Have you got a name in mind? If you want to choose your name, the only place where you are allowed to choose your own name is at our monastery in Perth. If you come to our monastery in Perth, certainly our monastery, you must choose your own name. If you ask Ajahn Brahm to give you a name, he will say, find your own name. I'm not going to think about your name, just find a name that is suitable. That's what I did. So I ended up as Brahm Mali, that's my name. Because I looked into the Theragata, I looked at some of the verses, and I saw Brahmali. I thought, I'm a disciple of Ajahn Brahm, so maybe Brahmali would be suitable. Same lineage. So how should you find a suitable teacher and a monastery? And what you should do is you should check out a few monasteries. Yeah, go to a few different places, see how they feel, see if it feels right for you. Stay there for a few days or a few weeks or whatever, and try out a few different things. Don't jump to any conclusions too fast, and then you will know what is right for you. I mean, I would always speak very highly of our monasteries in Perth, but I mean, I am biased, yeah? For obvious reasons, I have to be biased. So don't trust what anyone says. Make up your own mind by trying out a few different things. That is really the right approach. Okay, most monasteries, they will just tell you, this is your name, bang. Okay, yes sir, and you take it. End of story. Dear Ajahn, can prior knowledge of the stages of the progress in meditation be a hindrance, as the mind will be in a state of expectation of what's coming next? Or it doesn't really matter, as the mind will not be in control anyway during meditation? Well, this is a good point. That is a problem. If you have expectation, that will can definitely hinder your meditation. So the point is, you need to know, because you need to know the map. Yeah, you need to know whether you're heading in the right direction. So we cannot not know. That doesn't really work. But at the same time, you have to avoid expectations. And you learn that after a while, because after a while, you learn that the right way of meditating is just to sit back and relax and allow things to unfold. And as you do that, you actually don't really have so many expectations anymore, because you become good at this chilling. Yeah, and when you're chilling, you just allow things to happen. So that is what you need to do. That is the idea. That is really the way to go about this. And sometimes sometimes it's impossible not to have a little bit of expectation. But what happens over time is that you learn to see these states for what they are. There's always another state beyond. Yeah, everybody has been here already. So why am I getting so excited about it? It's not such a big deal. And after a while, you just kind of go up and up and up and beyond. Anjali Ajahn, number one, in which sutta does it mention the Buddha saw plants and trees can take rebirth as animals and human beings? As far as I know, no, there is no such sutta. I know that Ajahn Brahm sometimes makes this claim. I'm not sure what he bases that claim on. But in my experience, I'm not sure. You have to ask Ajahn Brahm that one, because I'm not sure what he's talking about in that one. Number two, I don't understand why Ajahn Gana said sleeping is doing something. If one is asleep, then one is not aware. But if one is falling asleep, then one is still aware. Thank you. Well, the point is, you have to fall asleep, yeah? And that, at that point, when you fall asleep, it's like you're turning off a switch, yeah? You're saying, okay, bang, enough. And you're turning off a switch, and then you fall asleep. It's not so much that you know, but if you are fully aware all the time, if you have clear awareness, you can't really fall asleep without clear awareness, because clear awareness is the opposite of a sleepy mind state. I'm bright awake, how can I be asleep? You can't. So if you want to go asleep from that clear awareness, you have to change your perception somehow to enable the mind to go asleep. And that's what he meant by doing something, that change of perception that allows you to go asleep. That is what that refers to. So Ajahn Gana has this very powerful mind, yeah? So he probably has to switch off something there to be able to fall asleep easily. Number one, Nibbana is the extinction of defilements, greed, anger, and delusion. Does in any sutta teach how to get rid of these defilements? Yes, Noble Eightfold Path. Yeah, that's the all the suttas say the Noble Eightfold Path is the way to get rid of these defilements. So practice the Noble Eightfold Path, and one day, bang, they are gone. And you think, whoa, that's pretty cool. No more greed, hatred, and delusion. Yay! And you're really happy as a consequence. Number two, what is more important from meditation practice, jhana or the abandoning of defilements? This is the same thing, these are not different. The path of meditation is a gradual abandonment of defilements, starting from the very beginning. Already when you start practicing right speech and right bodily action, you're already abandoning coarse defilements, yeah? This is part of the path. From the very beginning, you are abandoning defilements, making them weaker and weaker and weaker and weaker and weaker. And then you do sense restraint, you do contentment, you do the satisampajanya, all of these things, and then eventually you start watching the breath. Each stage on the path is a stage in abandoning these defilements. In jhana, these defilements have gone gone to sleep. They are still underlying, but they are gone completely for the duration of the jhana and even afterwards. And when they are gone completely, that's when you have the possibility afterwards of abandoning them once and for all, to be completely gone. So first of all, you overcome them through meditation, and then you abandon them completely through insight afterwards. That's how it works. Okay, last question for today. Some text says the highest attainment is asava jnana, where defilements are overcome. Do you agree? Asava kaya, I think it is, not asava jnana, but kaya, which means the ending of the asavas, are overcome. Do you? Yeah, so that's right. It is the same thing as ending of defilements. Yeah, the asavas are are often the kind of most deep-rooted defilements in human beings. There are three asavas. The kama asava, the asava of sensual desires, sensual pleasures. The bhava asava, the asava of existence. And the avijja asava, the avasava of delusion or ignorance. So these all have to be given up. And asava sometimes can be rendered as outflowing. Some people call it an influx, but I think outflowing is a quite nice idea. The idea that the mind, instead of being content inside, flows out into the world. Yeah, kama asava, the interest in the sensual world and all of that. You cut that off. Yeah, so there's no longer the flowing of the mind into the world. There's no interest in the worldly things. This is one way of looking at defilements. So these are just different ways of looking at the same thing. It's not as if Nibbana is either extinguishment or stillness, or the ending of defilements, or the ending of the asavas. It's all of those things into one. Yeah, these are just different ways of looking at the same thing, different aspects to the same thing, which is called Nibbana. Okay, that's all for tonight. Yeah. So let's just pay respect to Buddha.